This is All India Radio, Bangalore and Bhadravati. We now bring you the third and concluding talk in the series, The Times and the Trends of Our Freedom Struggle, which dealt with the development and the various phases of our freedom movement during the last 150 years. Sri K.C. Reddy now speaks on Gandhiji and independence.
India emerged as an independent nation on 15th August 1947. This was an epochal event in history. Many countries gained their independence before and some later than India did. But what is remarkable about Indian independence is that it was achieved by non-violent means instead of resorting to violence. This aspect of Indian independence will ever be enshrined in the temple of history as unique and deserving of homage and adoration. The main architect of this achievement was one of the greatest men of the world, Mahatma Gandhi, the apostle of truth and non-violence. Verily, he was the father of the Indian nation. It is not as if there were no efforts to free India from the chains of slavery before Gandhiji's advent. Several great sons and daughters of India, including a few foreigners, strove in their own way to rouse the spirit of nationalism in the people and make them realize they could be masters in their own home if only they made requisite efforts to that end. Spiritual giants like Ramakrishna Paramahamsa, Swami Vivekananda, Swami Dayananda Saraswati prepared the ground. The national poet Rabindranath Tagore roused the people culturally. To name only a few, political leaders of eminence, Ladabhai Nauroji, Firoz Shah Mehta, Surendranath Banerjee, Gopalakrishna Gokhale, Lokamanya Tilak, Motilal Nehru, Deshbandhu C.R. Das and Dr. Annie Besant contributed to the political awakening and progress of the country. The Indian National Congress was started in 1855 and till about 1920 it pursued moderate and constitutional methods to establish a democratic government. It was Tilak who declared Swaraj to be our birthright and demanded it. He paid the penalty for such a bold stand. Dr. Besant's Home Rule League did yeoman service and her dynamic leadership galvanized the nation for some time. The history of the freedom movement prior to 1920 is of absorbing interest, but that is outside the purview of my talk today. Suffice it to say that by and large, the methods adopted by the Congress were in the nature of passing resolutions, making representations, pleading for reforms, etc., trusting to the good sense of the rulers and hoping for good response from them, though now and then an aggressive spirit and dynamic action was not wanting by leaders like Lokamanya Tilak and Dr. Besant. It was, however, the entry of Gandhi into the political arena that brought about a transformation in the political scene. The Gandhian era may be said to have commenced in or about 1920. Divisions and disunity, selfishness and separatism, avarice and aggrandizement had sapped the strength of the nation and brought her under the heel of foreign rule. To end this dark and dismal state of affairs and bring about a bright and resurgent transformation, Gandhiji dedicated his life. He took the Congress to the masses and roused in them a spirit of patriotism and dynamism not manifest earlier. He forged unity among them, prodded them to action, controlled them when needed, and made them respond to the call of Satyagraha with a view to compel the foreign government to fulfill the popular demands. Men, women and even children, young and old, the rich and the poor, the peasant and the worker, the student and the artisan, the intelligentsia and persons belonging to various professions, in fact people of every strata of society were sucked into his movement by his appeal to join the struggle for Swaraj. What did Gandhiji mean by Swaraj? As early as in 1920, he wrote his Swaraj was parliamentary government of India in the modern sense of the term for the time being. Again in 1925, he said that by Swaraj he meant the government of India by the consent of the people, ascertained by the largest member of the adult population, male or female, native born or domicile, who have contributed by manual labor to the service of the state. As regards what constitution free India should have, he declared he would strive for a constitution which will release India from all thraldom and patronage and give her, if need be, the right to sin. He would work for an India in which the poorest shall feel that it is their country in whose making they have an effective voice. An India in which there shall be no high class or low class of people. An India in which all communities shall live in perfect harmony. There can be no room for the curse of untouchability or the curse of intoxicating drinks and drugs. Women will enjoy the same rights as men. All interests not in conflict with the interest of the dumb millions will be scrupulously respected, whether foreign or indigenous. He declared this was the India of his dreams and that he would be satisfied with nothing less. He clarified from time to time his conception of Swaraj. Once he characterized it as Ramarajya. Swaraj without Surajya would be a mere shell without substance. It was for the establishment of this kind of Swaraj that he organized the people to pursue with dedication and discipline various programs of action. The constructive program which he placed before the country was aimed at strengthening the fiber of the people and enable them to realize the Swaraj of his dreams. Gandhiji never failed to emphasize that the means adopted should be as pure and flawless as the ends to be realized. He preached the gospel of truth and non-violence and exhorted the nation never to deviate from them. He gave the nation the invincible weapon of satyagraha, resistance of evil, righteous indignation against untruth, rebellion against tyranny of any kind, without showing any personal ill will to the evildoer. All these were the essential ingredients of his satyagraha. He trained the nation incessantly in practicing this kind of satyagraha. If there was any deviation from the right kind of satyagraha, he had no hesitation to condemn or call off such pseudo-satyagrahas. The classical case of this kind was when he suspended satyagraha in 1921 and confessed to a Himalayan blunder on his part for having called upon people to offer satyagraha when they were not fully prepared for it and had not assimilated the essential principle and ingredient of satyagraha, namely non-violence. Jawaharlal Nehru chafed at this decision of Gandhiji, but ultimately bowed to the behest of his revered master. The various movements which Gandhiji launched over a period of about 25 years were all planned with meticulous care and abundant wisdom. At one time, the emphasis was on the constructive program comprising of propagation of Khadi, removal of untouchability, prohibition, communal harmony, and several other items to strengthen the people. At another time, he gave the call for direct action or satyagraha. One was preparation for the other. The people were often perplexed by what seemed to be strange and sometimes quixotic acts of the Mahatma. His various fasts undertaken for specific purposes were an enigma to many, but they ultimately served the purpose for which they were undertaken. He roused the masses for patriotic action as no other leader did. Magnificently responding to his call, they bore the cross of suffering without murmuring, nay, with a cheerful abandon. Lakhs of people filled the jails and suffered untold hardships. Students boycotted their schools, lawyers their courts, and many others left their avocations and plunged into the movement. Women came out of the seclusion of their homes and not only joined the struggle themselves, but inspired their menfolk to deeds of valor and daring. The national upheavings under Gandhiji's leadership were such that gave the ruling power many moments of anxiety and fear. Gandhiji's efforts to secure the country's freedom did not comprise wholly of direct action or satyagraha. As a true satyagrahi, he did not rule out friendly approaches, negotiations, and constitutional methods. He wrote to the various authorities as occasion demanded, pleading for their understanding and cooperation. His letters to viceroys are a class by themselves. He was not averse to meeting them and discussing matters with them. He attended committees and conferences to gain his objective by peaceful methods. It was only when such attempts failed and he saw no other alternative, he gave the call for direct action by way of civil disobedience or satyagraha. He was a militant pacifist. Only his militancy abjured violence. Gandhiji was also a supreme strategist. He knew when to go slow and when to speed up. He knew when to call people to concentrate on constructive program and when to offer satyagraha, which section of the people to do what at any particular point of time. I may cite as an example his lead to the people of the Indian states during the freedom struggle. He did not want them to carry on the struggle under the banner of the Indian National Congress. Instead, he preferred their having their own Praja Mandals to work for the establishment of popular rule, or responsible government, as we used to call it. Why did he advocate this method? He did not want to antagonize the princes in the states and their governments during the struggle with the British paramount power. He was certain that once the paramount power was liquidated, it would be an easy matter to come to terms with the princes. He did not therefore want to deal with them as opponents during his fight with British power. It was, in my humble opinion, a wise strategy which paid dividends. In fact, during the few months I stayed at Sevagram as a representative of the Mysore Congress, I was in close touch with Bapu on Mysore affairs, and on several occasions he left me in no doubt as to what strategy to have recourse to in dealing with Indian states. There are many aspects of Gandhiji's titanic contribution for the regeneration of India, but one which must needs be mentioned is his great gift to train leaders and create a band of followers who would follow him through thick and thin. What a band of followers he had! Jawaharlal, the jewel of India, Sardar Patel, the iron man, Rajagopalachari, the wise, Rajendra Prasad, Maulana Azad, Motilal Nehru, Deshbandhu C.R. Das, Pratap Sitaramaya and Prakasham, Dr. B.C. Rai, Govinda Vallabh Pant, Sarojini Naidu are just a few names that occur immediately to one's mind. Doubtless, there are many others, but time forbids a mention of all of them. The last phase of Gandhiji's work preceding independence was the famous Quit India movement, which he launched in 1942. It was a movement unique in the history of the world. The whole nation rose like one man to do or die in the attempt to make Britain quit India. Unparalleled sufferings were gone through. Violence of the ruling party rose to giddy heights, and alas, there was some violence on the part of a section of the people as well. Gandhiji was in jail and could do nothing about it. He lost his life partner Kasturba in jail, as also his devoted secretary Mahadev Bhai. He bore all this suffering and more in the cause of the country. People also were not found wanting to give their very best to the country's cause. The movement ended apparently in failure, but from out of the ashes of failure, success was not slow in coming. Success came ultimately in 1947. Lord Mountbatten representing Britain and Gandhiji and his followers came to terms, and independence to India, India was conceded. But alas, at what cost? India was partitioned. Pakistan became a new nation. Gandhiji did not approve of partition, but there was not much that he could do in preventing the catastrophe. True, he was disillusioned in the evening of his life in this regard. He contained his grief bravely and plunged himself in the great task of preventing and checking the horrors that came in the wake of partition. On Independence Day, he was not in Delhi to join the celebrations. He was playing the role of a lonely pilgrim elsewhere to heal the wounds of the suffering people, whether Hindu or Muslim. And the end came suddenly and tragically. He was shot dead by a fanatic Hindu. This ended the mortal life of a great man who was the father of the nation. His memory will ever be with the nation, and the future of the nation and its prosperity will depend on a faithful follow-up of the precepts he preached and followed in practice meticulously.
You were listening to Sri K.C. Reddy on Gandhiji and independence in the series The Times and the Trends of Our Freedom Struggle. This broadcast came to you from All India Radio, Bangalore and Bhadravati.